Hello and good morning, friends. Welcome to CEC EduSit Live Lecture. Dear friends, you know that women issues and children issues are most talked about. And today also we are going to talk on specially the violence against women and children. For this, we have with us in our studios Dr. Sushila Kaushik. Dr. Kaushik is a retired professor, and through our previous lectures also, she has focused more on the women's studies. And I hope that through this lecture also, we are going to get deep insight into this very topic, that is violence against this women and their children. So first of all, I would like to welcome our guest, Dr. Sushila Kaushik. Ma'am, welcome to the EduSit lecture. As I said, that women and children are most talked about, but still there are numerous questions to be answered, because sometimes we tend to say that, yes, certain things are what we're doing, but still we tend to forget certain things which needs to be done. So according to you, what basically constitute a violence, or what is a violence, especially when we talk about women and children alone?
Yeah, Geetika, first let me say good morning and to you as well as to the viewers. And that's precisely what I thought we would take up with, namely what is violence against women and why are we taking it up, this issue of violence today. Ever since we became independent, or even before that, since 1950 particularly, the nation has adopted a lot of social reforms, a lot of social legislations for women in this country, and quite a lot of our laws and measures are trying to remove this violence against women. But it is now 2014 or 15 we are getting into. Still, we do not seem to see that violence reducing in any way. In fact, more and more violence is coming up against women and children now, and the nature of violence, the types of violence, the way it is committed against women and children are getting more and more complex, and is increasing crime rate in this country against women and children. So this looks like a contradiction. What looks like a contradiction is, in spite of very many legislations, policy measures for the development and the empowerment of women in this country, a lot of commissions have come up over a period of time, a lot of recommendations and policies have come up over a period of time, some of which we saw in our previous talks, still we find the women are not able to access, get the benefit of most of these legislations, most of these policy measures. To me, it's one of the important reasons why the women are not able to access these benefits is mainly because of prevailing level of, degree of violence in this country. If women are subject to violence all the time, they cannot come out and then use whatever benefits, whatever policy measures or instruments we are creating for them. That's why very often in women's studies we believe that violence is at the basis of the women's empowerment, of what prevents the women's empowerment and development, rather than only being treated as any other human problem. This is not merely human, it definitely is a human rights problem, but also it is a developmental problem. It is also something which the state needs to deal with as a part of its responsibility, and not to distract the women from improving themselves, empowering themselves, so we have to get rid of this violence. Now, when we talk in terms of violence against women, there are certain things which we need to make sure about it. How do we define violence in the case of women? Is there any difference between the violence against women and violence against men? Men, often we think the violence is only in terms of physical violence, murder, injury, beating. These are the things we believe as violence against men and women. But there is more than that. In the case of women, we find that violence could be without even having any physical harm done. Mental cruelty, mental violence is much more prevalent day in and day out, within and outside the family, more than it is available for the men. So that is where when it comes to violence in the case of women, we need to first define ourselves as to violence which take place within the family, violence which take place outside the family, violence which take place in your parental family, violence which take place in your marital family, violence which takes place when you are young, violence which takes place when you are old. So women of any age, any place, any class, any caste go through violence in our system, and this violence could be both physical, visible, or it could be also not at all visible, mental, and in the form of direct attack, or it could be even the form of remarks, which are often snidey remarks, but all the same cause a certain amount of burning in the hearts of the women. So we would like to expand the definition of violence to include all these various forms of causing any injury to the mind, to the brain, and to the body of the women and children in this country. Now, over a period of time, when you are looking up, you find there is a deep increase in the crimes against women. When you think in terms of the various data which come up before us, you find that in spite of all this improved type of legislations and police action and other machineries which have come into being, still the general picture is one of more and more crimes against women. This is very sad, but that's a fact. And in fact, the police records, Delhi Police Records Bureau, there is a Delhi Police Records Bureau, which through its research is collecting a lot of data on the women, and they come out, every year they come out with an annual report which they talk about the various types of crime and compare it to the present year and the past years. They have listed so far about 10 different types of crime against women. It doesn't mean it's very exclusive, doesn't mean it's very exhaustive. There can be many more crimes which we can envisage, or the others, NGOs, women's studies scholars are all collecting. But this Crimes Record Bureau's data is becoming universally adopted, and it's a record which we can compare with because it's coming out every day, not merely for Delhi, but also for entire India, on the basis of the cases which are filed in the various courts or various police stations all over India. Of course, it is not complete. Of course, it is not exhaustive, mainly because it only has those records for which there is an FIR as filed or somebody takes the issue to the court. Just as in the case of medicine, we only know the records from those who go to a doctor. Here also those records only we have who go to the police station, but it is indicative. It gives you a trend. It tells you a certain idea about where were we a few years back and where are we now, whether the crime, a particular crime is decreasing or is increasing. If it is increasing, why so? What are the social, economic, political, or sociological factors which has led to over a period of time a certain types of crimes increasing, perhaps a certain types of crimes hopefully are also decreasing for reasons of education, development, or reasons of legislation, police action. It could be many reasons, but the crimes could be coming down over a period of time. So we'll take it up in a little more seriously. And this 10 different fields which they are giving has both men and women data, but the police records are also segregating these days between the crimes against men and the crimes against women, and gives the total picture for entire India. It's a very big record which many of our libraries have it, so we must be able to see them to know exactly where we figure in various parts of India. This violence against women, when you see the police record or even otherwise when we know about what's happening around in this country, starts even before a child is born. Especially in the case of girls, the violence against unborn children, the violence against newly born children is much, much more in the case of girl children than in the case of male children. we all have known about the feticide now, where the sex determination test takes place in various parts of India, and the sex, particularly in certain regions more than in certain other regions, particularly in the urban regions more than in the rural regions, we find the feticide, as it is called, that is known even before a child is born as to what is going to be the sex of that child. And then if you don't like a particular baby, male child or a female child, then sort of getting rid of even the fetus itself even before it is born. It is often done only against the girl child. Because of the general principle, general mentality of our people all over the world, but definitely in the case of India much more, of preferring a son, a male baby, to a girl baby. Even if you have no girls before, very often the family resorts to it. They have their own logic about it, which we don't agree at all with. Very often we get rid of the female child and give a preference to a male child. Sometimes when you have a policy like a two-child norm, or you have a policy like a one-child norm as in China, then we would like to have that one child or the two children only males, then we also lead it to this. But very often the feticide in our country particularly is taking place mainly because of a male preference, for property reasons, for religious reasons, and perhaps also because the child's life is much more cruel in future years and than the case of a boy. Whatever it is, India is one of the few countries which is notorious for this sort of feticide. This feticide, and then even if the child is born sometimes, the female child is also get rid of very often. Various ways in which they get rid of, one shouldn't mention it, but these are common, namely abandoning the child. As soon as a girl child is born, you just abandon the child, throw it in a dustbin or throw it in a nala, in a garbage, so that if somebody wants to pick up, they can pick up, or it will die its natural death. There are very many other ways in which, cruel ways in which they have identified methods of getting rid of a child who is already born. But we all know there is an infanticide issue in this country, and in this infanticide, the number of girls being killed is much more than the number of boys. So with the result, putting together, feticide and infanticide has brought out our sex ratio in extremely low terms. India is one country where we have even by 2011 a very low sex ratio of 940 for 1000 males. This is when we know a newborn girl child is stronger than a newborn male child, and a newborn girl child can survive a lot of challenges to its life better than a boy child can. But we find in the 0 to 6 age group, our census again and again points out that almost from 1900 onwards, this is true, that the female child is much less than the girl child. So currently in 2011 data, we have 940 to 1000 male child. This is very sad. It reflects extremely badly, not so much on our health and medical system as much as on our psychological and our social values and social system. So this is a violence. This is the very first violence, even when you are born or when you are not yet born. Then as we move up our age group, the children of various age groups face different types of problems and different types of violence. The one which is now coming up very seriously and which is very sad and very horrifying is the sexual violence against female infants and girls. One doesn't know it, the real reasons for it, but one knows the number of small kids, 3 months old, 6 months old, 3 years old, 6 years old, and even up to the age of 12, the number of girls who are being molested or raped is increasing tremendously. One doesn't know the reason behind it as yet, but one finds one comes across, even recently in some cities of metro cities of India, we are again and again listening to more and more small girls being raped or molested and suffer from the injuries as a result of this inhuman violence which has been put on them. This is also true of girls in the school going age. We find a lot of girls in the schools, in a co-ed or a single school, it doesn't matter, are going through this problem of being molested, sexually violated, sexually assaulted, and within the school premises as well as outside, either in the bus or as they are walking on the roads or going home as such. Also, we find a lot of neighborhood type of crimes taking place against the small children, by inducing them with some sort of peppermint or some sort of a chocolate. A lot of neighbors and others really misuse, abuse the children and the right to live freely. That's when the violence starts very early against women. But as we are growing in the family, we find there are other ways in which the family itself sort of discriminates against the children. We never realize it. The parents never realize it. The elder members of the family often never realize that they are discriminating against the children. Whether it is in the form of food or in the form of health, whether in the form of taking a person to a doctor or giving medicines to the girl child and the boy child, we find often there is a sort of a carelessness and negligence, a way of playing a secondary importance to a girl child. We just ignore the girl child's health, ignore the girl child's food, and give preference in our items to the male child. Sometimes it is done because of poverty, definitely, and scarcity, because the families are not well off to distribute equally to all members. But more often than not, it is based on a clear-cut discrimination in the family of preferring a male child to a female child. It's also based on a lot of myths about the girl child's health. She coming to puberty at an earlier age, and that she doesn't require too much of protein. So I've heard a lot of families denying the girls egg or meat or milk, and then giving such protein rich items only to males, because they believe that the males have to develop fast, they will grow tall, they will have muscles, they have to be strong enough to do very muscle oriented tough jobs, whereas the women don't need this, and they are supposed to be soft, they are supposed to be feminine, so they should not be eating those sort of food. So with this sort of mental attitudes which we have within girls and boys, we really very often deny the girls what is really needed for them, namely high nutritious and protein rich food, vitamin rich food, at an age where they really require it. This is the age of puberty. This is the age when you build up the girl's body, the girl's bones, the girl's calcium, the girl's blood circulation, because when soon she'll be an adult and then she may become a mother. If you hear a lot of child mothers dying or mothers at a young age, after infancy, after delivery, dying, the real reason is they have not been given proper nutrition, necessary nutrition, when they were children, as they were growing up. But the families don't realize this. They very often make this discrimination. This is not merely a health practice, it is also violence against girls. Because discriminating against the girls definitely creates in them a certain amount of sorrow, sadness, feeling of being ignored, a feeling of being discriminated. And a lot of girls grow with this feeling of being tortured and discriminated during their childhood. It really works on their psyche. Then we also have in the field of higher education. Once again, the children are sent to schools, boys and girls, but we find the girls are not being sent to those courses or to those colleges, those institutions where perhaps the children, there is not enough facilities for girl child. So you find that if the school is at a distance, we don't send the girls there, but then we send the boys. If the girls' schools don't have any toilets, we don't send the girls. Girls themselves drop out. I'm happy we are now realizing this. A lot of dropouts in the girls is taking place because of lack of toilets in the schools. Good toilets, clean toilets with the water facility in the school. We also don't send girls beyond a particular age to a co-ed school. In most parts of India, girls are sent to school only if there is a single segregated type of schools and not if it is a co-ed. As you go further, then you have to spend money on their fees, spend money on their hostel and spend them. Then the parents really prefer to give whatever little money they have to a boy than to a girl. We have had very many cases of where the boy may not be as skilled, as good technically or as knowledge-wise as the girl may be, as the daughter may be. But the daughter is always given a second preference, and against her own will, she is asked to do courses which she is not wanting to do, but the boys are sent to colleges or technical institutions and professional institutions, even if they don't come up so well. This is a tremendous discrimination which we have been adopting. A lot of girls have kept crying on this. A lot of girls even feel deprived of it and go about doing things with a sullen heart and with a sense of deprivation of throughout their life. Keep remembering this backwards. Thereby, it's a mental cruelty which we are doing on the girls as such. Then as we grow up, the next stage comes up where we think in terms of marriage. Marriage means in India motherhood, and that automatically involves motherhood. So we not only marry them when they are suitable age for marriage, but we begin bringing them up to mold them in the context of a marriage and motherhood. So from the very beginning, the socialization process starts. From the very beginning, we tell the girls, do not play certain games, do not go out certain times, this doesn't suit you, you cannot climb, you cannot do high jump, you cannot go up the ladder, these are all boys, don't play tough games. Very often I heard girls coming and telling me in the school, ma'am, we wanted football, but they will give football only to boys and not to us. The girls made to play indoors while the boys go out and play in the thing. So this sort of discrimination, once again, our schools continue to perform as a part of a continuation of the socialization process, which a gender stereotyping process, which the families do. So the schools, instead of reversing it, also follow the same practice. So socialization of the girls from the very way in which they wear clothes. The clothes which are prescribed to them really start from the time they are 7 days old. We buy different type of dress for a boy, different type of dress for a girl. And it goes on till almost the end of her life that she is not expected to wear something which the boys wear. She is expected to wear only what is prescribed for them as girls or women later on. So these are all we don't understand that causes a lot of mental violence, mental cruelty, disappointment to the girls. In turn, she is deprived of the opportunities, which itself is a form of violence as such. So marriage and motherhood becomes extremely important to a woman. Of course, marriage takes place with a man, so it becomes equally important to a man. But the way you bring up a child from the time she is almost 8 years old is to prepare her for a marriage and what follows after marriage, like domestic chores, behavior pattern, femininity about herself, her physical activities. Whereas in the case of a boy, you bring up a boy for doing activities, for a professional training, for becoming somebody very professional in life, job, work, employment, earning. These sort of ideas are put into a boy, while marriage is the one idea which is put in the case of a woman. Her body becomes very important. The body which bears the motherhood becomes more important to her than the brain or any other capacity or skill which a girl might have or might want to develop to have. So all this in a way leads to tremendous amount of mental violence at home. It leads to a lot of suppression and subordination at home. So from the very beginning, the family itself, knowingly or unknowingly, for economic or not so economic factors, even the rich families it takes place. In fact, I find the richer families, they are more supportive of their girls than even the lower middle class families or even the poorer families, where for a girl to go out and work becomes more important and imperative than for a richer family. Then comes, as we grow still older, or you need not even be older these days, even it starts at the age of 6 or 7, you find the sexual violence is becoming an extreme open and disguised form of violence against women. There are various types of sexual violence we keep talking about, but the most important, the most common one, which is also doing tremendous harm to the women, is the molestation and rape, which take place within the house and outside the house very often. There's also increasing evidence of incest. That is, somebody who is closely related to you, who is supposed to be your guardian, who is supposed to be your custodian, with whom you can have easy relationship without bringing sex into the picture at all, even those people seem to be doing raping on you. In fact, the incest relationship is coming out more and more open now. The data is coming out more and open now because the girls are able to mention it, the mothers are able to come out again. Lots of cases of fathers raping the daughters is coming out in this country, which we never thought of before. And so you find, in fact, the police says most of the rape and most of the incest, all the incest in fact, and most of the rape takes place only from people who is known to the girls. Unknown persons on the road, there are rapes like that, but this also, according to police records, that most of it is run by those whom you know before, because then the girl goes along easily and then finds herself being molested, raped by the very same character on whom she has a certain amount of faith. That's the very inhuman part of the whole stuff. It restricts girls' movement. It is not merely a violence against her body, it's a tremendous violence against her body, it is a total shock to her brain. The mind doesn't think of anything else after that, it changes her mindset completely. Many of them become dropouts in life. Even if they continue to do various activities, these incidents of violence keep haunting her as she goes off. Her whole attitude to men changes. Her whole attitude to profession changes, and so we find the girls really living half their lives if they go through such experiences at whatever age it may be. Even if she's 65, sometimes one has heard she's being raped, it still bothers her. So it's a tremendous amount of violence, particularly against her body, but also against her mind, against her whole life pattern as such. Then has come up a new one, which is called sexual violence and harassment at public and workplaces. Now, once again, this is something which you have recognized now. It's not that it never took place before. It's not that men were not behaving to women, not in a proper way in the offices for a long time. But a definition came up about the sexual harassment. What is a sexual harassment? Leering at the girls, smiling at them unnecessarily, saying words which is not liked by her, coming and standing behind her or pulling her chunni or pulling her sari or pulling her hair when she is either in the office or in the bus or going anywhere. These were not considered previously as sexual harassment. We used a very innocent word at that time, eve teasing. It's only a teasing. It is not really something which is more harmful than that. But now we have moved on to recognize them as violence. It's violence against the girls, whether you just laugh at them, you just make lewd remarks against them, you make fun of them, you make fun of their dress, or you do anything physically, it still hampers her, it still makes her not free on the roads, not free in the office, and give the best to her, of hers, to the work she's doing at home. or in the office. So with the result, we have now got a judicial pronouncement on this, namely sexual harassment at public places and at working places. So especially our students, girl students, are victims of this quite often. Our young women in the offices are victims of this quite often. Phone calls keep coming in. Buses are being used. We know a lot of cases where not merely rape. Rape is a little extreme form, but even harassment takes place in our buses. If you go with anybody in an auto or in a taxi, it can take place. Nothing, you just walk on the road, it can take place. So with the result, women's movements are totally curbed. Their behavior is totally curtailed because of this fear. A lot of women walk on the roads with tremendous fear, and many people say that, the one thing they want to get rid of is the fear. The fear, even if harassment doesn't take place, the fear that harassment may take place, that if a man comes close, he is coming mainly to harass her or to do anything more violent than that, is a sort of a feeling that harms the woman completely. So this is vile. Anything which the woman does not like, does not enjoy, does not want, which she resents, is definitely a violence, and that is definitely a sexual harassment. Fortunately, we have had a judicial verdict on it. Now we also have a law against it, which is prohibiting a lot of sexual harassment. A lot of stuff which was taking place in the public lives, women's public lives, could now be brought under this crime called sexual harassment. The police are taking care of it. Offices are taking care of it. The CEOs are worried about it because a lot of women are leaving and going from their profession because of this. And so one is encouraging them to come out with these complaints so that it could be really removed and they can pursue their career later on. The most cruel of this is now taking place in bulk in honor killings. Now, honor killing, a word which is a misnomer, definitely is not honor. Killings definitely they are, and it's particularly associated with certain regions in our country, but it's spreading very, very fast in other parts of India too. Areas which are not known for honor killings are now going to go witnessing more and more of honor killings. Honor killings will particularly apply in the context of marriage between a boy and a girl. When a boy and a girl get married on their own, which is either not following a certain prescribed religious customary traditions, or even if it is against the desire of their parents, if it is an intercaste marriage or something like this, then the parents are objecting to it, that often the boys and girls, if they insist on continuing with their affair and then want to get married or get married, then the parents, instead of reconciling to it one way or other, the parents really kill them. Very often it is taking place in a state called Haryana or western side of Uttar Pradesh, but it's now also spreading to other states. Even Tamil Nadu has some data which gives us honor killings. So it's not merely just a punishment, just a violence against the children, like beating or scolding or anything, or boycotting, but even precisely killing them, in some cases both the boy and girl, some cases only the girl, some cases only the boys. But all these things are in turn is also leading to murder. It is one way of murder of the young, but we call it as honor killing. The newspaper and the media has really brought out this word, which everybody is now using very wrongly. Yes, this is not the honor of the parents. This is the rights of the young. The rights of the young to choose their partner, the rights of the young to live their life the way they want to, which is being killed in the form of these honor killings, which is increasing, but which is also being opposed in a lot of societies in India right now. I don't want to get into the details of it right now, maybe some other time, but in the name of gotras, in the name of caste, in the name of region, in the name of same village, in the name of religion, we are killing our young. And this way, we are not going to have too many young people. Also, very soon, the sex ratio, even in the youth, may begin to be addressed as a sex ratio in the infant stages, bad disadvantages to girl children in this country. Then we get married, other types of violence starts, dowry starts. Dowry is something which is tremendously ignominious for women. It's a real shame for women because it devalues the women. It completely believes women are nothing but bundles of luggage. Women are not capable of anything. Women cannot look after themselves. Women are not income earners. Women, when they go into mothers in to the marital homes, they merely become a consumer. They merely become a burden. So the parents are supposed to give along with the girl a certain amount of jewelry, certain amount of cash, certain amount of other types of things, bartan, which is vessels, saris, many other things go up. Not merely to the girl or for the girl, but very often never to the girl, never for the girl, but even for the relatives, in-laws and others. The cash is also going up tremendously, maybe because of an inflation. There's a big inflationary trend there. But that itself is violent. That itself is violent for the parents. And that's one of the reasons why the parents really think of girls as a burden from the time they are born. They don't invest on the girls because they always go to another person's house. And as they go after marriage to another person's house, they also cost a lot of money to the parents. So that's why also perhaps the girls are got rid of even before they are born in this country. So dowry has been a very big reason for the low sex ratio, the bad socialization, the lack of education, the lack of empowerment of women, and believing there's no point in investing on the girls, there is more point in investing on the boys. The boys get the preference all along the way. And it has led of late to a lot of problems following the dowry issue. We have a legislation which says that within 7 years after marriage, if a death of a girl takes place, or even she walks out of the house or pushes back to that her marital home, her parental home, it could be called a dowry issue. But very often, even after 7 years of age, this dowry continues to be a demand made by them. A lot of violence takes place on women on the basis for the sake of the dowry. Death takes place because of the dowry. Suicide takes place more than that because of the dowry demand. Because many girls who are so ashamed of going back or bothering their parents or consider this as a immoral stuff end up committing suicide. So this is a tremendous loss for us as young girls, and this is a shame for India because it's India of all the countries, even in South Asia, has the maximum amount of dowry violence. Then you escape dowry or you don't have a, you have a dowry problem, but you still have a patriarchal violence which is being perpetrated against women in this country. Or all over the world, but it's still domestic violence is a very widespread violence in the case of married women or even not married women, even in the case of young children. Parents beating up the children, brothers beating up the young girls, the males are being beaten up in the homes there they work, and of course the wives are being beaten up quite a lot. Recently, a survey pointed out that 80% of the men who were surveyed confessed they have beaten their wife sometime or other. So beating the wife, doing any other type of violence, burning her hands, I don't want to get into the description of it because it's too inhuman to mention them, but there are lots of ways in which the families perform this violence on the women. From death, murder, killing, burning, to even small things, the violence continues both mentally as well as physically in married homes for a lot of women who look forward to old age maybe as a remedy for this violence. All this adds up All this is not merely physical, but all this also adds up to her mental cruelty. Sometimes in a marital home, you don't get dowry, you don't have a dowry demand, you don't have a violence, but there's a constant smiting. From morning till evening, you are constantly being said something or other against yourself, against your parents, against your figure, against your color, against your physical makeup, against your brain, against your knowledge. And this sort of a stuff goes on all through the day, insult after insult. That also is a violence, though we don't often recognize this as violence. The women suffer from this, women broke it in silence, women show tears on this, women scream, but it is violence whatever way you react to this. Lately we found this, apart from sex determination which we talked about, a sex determination test is not always by the mothers. We very often believe the decision to have a sex determination test and then throwing out a female fetus is the responsibility of a woman, and so we go about preaching to her, don't do it. But very often the sex determination is imposed on the woman by her in-laws. It is the in-laws, the family, the husband who want really a male child, and so they push the woman to go through sex determination. There are cases where the women have resisted it, but most often they find it's impossible to resist this. Then she also succumbs to it, and so whether she is willing or not willing, she is made to go through the test and also perhaps kill the female baby. Vasectomy is another way of killing a woman's body. Namely, recently we have had a lot of issues on this, a lot of experiments which have gone awry in this country. The women go through vasectomy, that is family planning measure to restrict more child being born. And though the tubectomy, which is usually done on men, is more easy, quick, with no consequences, men do not prefer to go through tubectomy. With the result, the family planning is always aimed at the body of the woman, which is called vasectomy. We had a very big recent case in Chhattisgarh, but also highlighted what's happening in the rest of India by way of vasectomy. And we find a lot of women, in fact, almost all, more than 99% of family planning operations which have gone on in this country by way of camps by the government agencies or even privately have been done on the women rather than on the men. So we call it sterilization. And the vasectomy has been again a violent part on women because more difficult for women to go through it, it requires more rest and it needs a lot more hygienic and other career surroundings, and she also is for a while take to rest. So the labor women who lose wages during 1 or 2 days or whatever, there is a lot of violence involved in it, but we have taken it up for ourselves to do it on the women, and the women go through it mainly because, willingly or otherwise, because they know what it is to have more babies, bear more babies, and it's their health, their life, their work which gets affected finally. Bigamy in India is something on which we don't even have enough data. Bigamy is not something which even police records. They don't seem to consider this as a crime against women at all. We have two types of things in this country. One is bigamy, is closely associated with that is the separation. On separation, which is a very peculiar institution to South Asia, and bigamy also is quite a peculiar institution to South Asia, but of course others also have it. A man getting married again to more than one wife, sometimes against the religious dictates, sometimes because they believe religion allows it, but either way, it is never a happy affair for the wife to have the man, husband going and marrying another woman. And the separation is one where the original woman doesn't even know that the man has got married and he is living another life very happily, while she is somewhere in a lonely corner, fending for herself, waiting for the husband to come back home, and looking after very often the children and the livelihood of the family. In India, we have a lot of instances of separation. a lot of rural women particularly are leading a separated life, but they don't even know where the husband is, what he is doing. A lot of migrant men, when they go abroad in terms of first job and earning and all, the women are living separately at home, not knowing when he is coming back, whether he will come back, with whom he will come back, whether she will get any benefit out of it. This is one area we require a lot of data in this country. Because divorce in this country has not been much of a happy affair. We do have a lot of people who are now going in for divorce on mutual consent, but the majority of divorce cases are still a very difficult process in this country, and therefore divorce itself is preceded by a lot of violence in this country. The divorce process is very violent in this country. The post-divorce is also very violent in this country, because the maintenance which the men have to pay for their wives, the children, is often not coming through properly. The many women can have no way of extracting the maintenance later, and the court injunction every time you can't go to. So these are areas where the women suffer a lot in daily lives, in common language and common parlance, whether they are rural or urban, educated or uneducated, lower caste or upper caste, or any religion in this country, which has a lot of religions, where all these various types of violence, both post-marital and other things, are taking place as such. So some of these violence the police have captured, but many of these violence the police have not captured in the records at all. A new type of violence which we are also introducing into the violence, which police doesn't seem to worry about, but we as scholars will be worried about, is the political violence against women. War. The United Nations has recognized war and the impact of war and the process of war on the women and the children. Not merely the women become agents of war, not merely women become consequences of the war and they have the impact of war and suffering. The majority become widows out of war, and then comes the livelihood issue, the children's, looking after the children issue, but also the men, quite a few women also lose their lives in their war itself. War also leads to a lot of migrancy pattern. The life is affected, housing is affected, schooling is affected, livelihood is affected. And women and men, the family as a whole, or sometimes the men stay back, women come away. So the migrancy as an issue comes up. And we find in big areas, big cities, in slums, the majority of inhabitants are really migrants and refugees from war. And the refugees have their own problem, migrants have their own problem, but they have development issues, health issues. And the women bear the brunt of it even more because, once again, sexual violence against refugees, sexual violence against women becomes a lot more increasing as a result of war, as a result of violence, social violence, as a result of political violence, riots, communal riots or any other riot also leads to a lot of violence against women. Women suffer the most, bear the brunt of the war and the riots as much as men do, but even more than the men do. All this violence is in a way very individually bad for the woman. It's collectively bad for the family. It's bad for the society. In fact, we haven't yet begun feeling, computing the laws in terms of our social impact because of violence on women. There are very few studies in this country which has been done about the economic cost of violence against women, economic cost of rapes against women, economic cost of riots and war on women and children. We do not have any studies as such, very proper studies. It's a field, an area which is very virgin, which is still need to be analyzed quite a lot. We also have political violence in the case of politics, really political. I came across an instance 3 days back in the paper. A panchayat chairwoman was raped and then murdered. Another panchayat chairwoman, lots of panchayat women members have been threatened to be a member or to give up. The chairpersons have especially have gone through a lot of threat by the men in the villages or families which are opposed to them to give up and go, because if she gives up, the election will take place and a man can come in her position. Many reasons are there, but violence and threat, fear of kidnapping of children, murder of the husband or a family member, these are the various types of murder threats which our panchayat women are going through day in and day out when they come boldly forward to accept membership in the panchayat or chairpersonship and contest the elections. The election itself has a lot of violence in it, which also women face. So political violence very often stop the women from going forward and contesting the elections or participating in the politics of this, formal politics of this country, particularly Panchayati Raj. The other important social impact of it is, as we saw before, the demographic imbalance, adverse sex ratio. The society of ours is losing totally a gender balance. We have very few women for a lot of men, which is not really good for the country's development in the long run. Any country should have a balanced population demographic distribution between men and women. If possible, naturally speaking, men should be even more than the women. There are lots of Western countries where you have a lot more women than the men. But South Asia is one country, one region, where the sex ratio of women are less. Out of them, India is definitely one we have to worry about. The sex ratio of women is less because it's now leading to a lot of social consequences. Not merely it's bad for women, bad for preventing the girls from coming in, but it's also leading to a gender imbalance. We all know, we are seeing more and more of it. The lowest sex ratio, like as in Haryana, where it is coming down from 9:29, 9:30. National average is 9:40. The brides are not available anymore for the men of Haryana. It's for the past 10 years, this is being witnessed. The number of women being less than the men and the families have to hunt for brides from other regions of India, if they stick to caste and religion. But even now they even went farther away to believe any woman is okay, because they are also agricultural families, cultivating families. They do need more hands for them, cultivation. So they began importing people from Kerala, from northeast, in order that their sons will get married and there will be a procreation in the family, but also they will get hands for the agricultural cultivation. This is a very sad situation, because very often this is not done very smoothly and nicely, but at the cost of sale and purchase of girls. A lot of money transactions are coming to, girls are being bought, girls who do not belong to a religion, do not belong to a language, to a region, are being brought in, so that it leads to a lot of marital discord later on, running away, kidnapping, rape, many other issues are all coming up. So there is a lot of tension in the families which have come up in these areas, mainly because of it. They are realizing it now. The Kaap Panchayat, as we call, is diluting itself. They are now allowing girls' marriage customs to be changed, so that they can avail themselves of the girls who are available within the region itself. But if it's still not possible because of our sex ratio, they are also going beyond and getting girls from other languages and regions of India. And the caste is losing its strong power there, mainly because of this administrative necessity, marriage necessity. The imbalance between boys and girls is also leading to a lot of social crimes, a lot of rapes, elopement, kidnapping, which we are seeing more and more as a police recorded crime in our country. When the girls are falling short in supply, then you begin eloping them with them, or you begin kidnapping them. A lot of parents even silently encourage this kidnapping when they find the girl is good enough and they would like to have that girl in their family. So the sexual violence and social crimes are increasing because of this adverse balance we have in this. We also have a lot of male juvenile crimes in the big cities of India, mainly because of lack of girls, lack of interaction, lack of girls in the schools, very few girls in the schools, in a co-education school, so the interaction becomes less and less. Then, in order to overcome this issue of lack of brides, and the brides running away after, or the girls running away after when they come of age or get a certain amount of education, choosing their own boys, there's a big demand in the villages, particularly of Haryana and the other conservative areas in this country, of reducing the age of marriage. At present, the girls cannot get married before they are 18. There are a lot of violations are there, child marriages are there, but at least law-wise. But so they are now asking for the girls' age to be reduced to 16 or if possible even to 14, so that the girls will be available to them even at the age of 14. And others, they don't go out of the village, they don't go out into the education system, they don't go into the job, so that they can get more and more brides for their sons. So this is the reason why we have so much of violence, some type of sexual violence and others taking place. But there are also the other social impact of it. We have a lot of child mothers, child marriages, child mothers dying. India's rate of female mortality rate is very high, and especially the pregnancy related deaths are very, very high in this country. Illiteracy and dropout rate is very high, mainly because of the violence which we are perpetuating against these small girl child at home, or the schools not worrying about them. The economic cost is something which we have not calculated, which we should do, because women constitute half of the human resource in this country. And they begin contributing the resource even when they are born. By the time they are 5 or 6, they have begun participating in the work at home. By the time 14 or 13, they have begun participating in your household occupations as such. By the time they are 14 and above, they begin to be labor. So you find that the girls are really human resource, and so also definitely women. So if you do violence against women, push them indoors, or discourage them, devalue them, demoralize them with violence, your nation is suffering from the point of view of human resource development, from the point of view of their contribution to your national production, national income. So this is how you find that politically the women become unempowered. Even if you have reservation, it won't satisfy enough. You may have enough of women, but they may not be the correct type of women you may have. And if you don't have reservation, not many women come forward, because before the election, during the election and after the election, they go through a lot of violence. And unfortunately, our democracy in this country has come to be attributed as a violence event rather than as a very peaceful event as such. And women, young people, are really avoiding the elections because of democracy itself or politics itself because of violence.
What are the goals? This note, we would like to thank you, ma'am, because we have almost time gone, but you have laid some important points regarding the violence against the children as well as women. I hope that in future lectures also we would be able to talk more about what could be done and what far we have to do. So with this note, we would like to thank you, and thank you so very much, ma'am.